Have you ever wondered why some develop insulin-resistant type 2 diabetes and others do not? There are those who live on junk food, sodas, and fast food all of their lives, yet their metabolic markers like triglycerides, blood pressure, and blood sugars all remain normal. The key to this mystery has finally been solved. And the big surprise, it has nothing to do with how much body fat one has. Not only has the specific genes been exposed, but how and why these mutated cells become dysfunctional. If preventing or reversing diabetes is your main goal, then that can only be accomplished if you understand why diseases like diabetes occur in the first place. Welcome to the Resilient Diabetic. Please don't forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And if you've learned something new today, please smash that like button for me. Diabetes in general refers to a group of diseases that affect how our bodies use blood sugar or glucose. The underlying causes of diabetes does vary by type, but what we all have in common, regardless of type, the quality of our lives depends on how well our blood sugars are controlled. I am personally a solid believer in all diabetics keeping that A1C in those lower levels of that non-diabetic range. I was, as of 9 years ago, diagnosed as a late onset insulin dependent type 1 diabetic due to an autoimmune attack. But what really worried me when I was first diagnosed was why I could not control my blood sugars with flat, well controlled lines. And what I realized quickly was using more and more insulin to try and control carbohydrate intake, regardless of the type of carbohydrate, made my health worse. I was afraid of becoming what's known as a double diabetic because of my own personal genes. That is where a type 1 becomes insulin resistant and has to use more and more insulin just to bring down blood sugars. That leads us to our main question. Have you ever wondered why some people develop type 2 diabetes and others don't? The answer to that question has finally been revealed with brand new evidence. And the key to this mystery all lies beneath the skin. It starts and actually ends with your fat cells. A study published in the Journal of Lipid Research exposed metabolic pathways in subcutaneous fat in a group of people who developed diabetes. Basically, fat cells under the skin are not very good at storing fat. This leads us into some staggering statistics. In 2000, the global estimate of adults living with diabetes was 151 million. By 2009, it had grown by 88% to 285 million. A decade ago, in 2010, the global projection for diabetes for 2025 was 438 million. With over 4 years still left to go, that prediction has already been surpassed by 25 million. IDF estimates that there will be 578 million adults with diabetes by 2030. And 700 million by 2045. Yes, you heard that right. You will know why this is happening and will continue to happen at an exponential rate. It has generally been taught by the scientific community that adult humans past the teenage years cannot create new fat cells. We have thought until now that fat cells can only increase their fat mass by adding more lipids into existing fat cells, like blowing air into a single balloon. the new mind-blowing revelation, certain adults can produce new fat cells regardless of their body weight, status, sex, or age. The big discovery: one develops metabolic diseases and diabetes not based on how much fat they have, but who is getting fat through a process called hypertrophy and who's getting fat through a process called hyperplasia. So either one of these processes will dominate when adipose fat cells are getting larger. Hypertrophy is when each individual fat cell is getting bigger, but the number of fat cells isn't changing. So that person has the same number of fat cells, but each cell is getting very big, 3 to 4 times bigger than normal. On the other hand, some genetically have fat cells that grow through hyperplasia. And this is when that fat cell may get a little big, but before it gets too big, it simply splits and makes new baby fat cells to store all that extra energy coming in. If one is blessed with hyperplasia, the potential to get fat is almost limitless. They can continue to get fatter and fatter. Now, that person, ironically, as they get fatter, they also stay insulin sensitive. So even though they are overweight or even obese, they do not become diabetic. And that's because the fat cells always have more room to store fat because new cells are created. On the other side, as fat cells grow bigger and bigger in those who cannot grow new cells, they eventually become insulin resistant. This is done to prevent the cells from dying, to ensure its own survival. But in the process, to save itself when it's completely full, rather than bursting, it starts leaking two things. A hypertrophic fat cell that is full starts leaking both fatty acids back into the bloodstream, and it also starts leaking pro-inflammatory proteins. The other big hammer dropped by these incredible studies: there are people who are genetically predisposed to one or the other, and we very much see this across ethnicities. Those that are East Asian, Indian, Asian, and Hispanic, for example, have fat cells that are predominantly hypertrophic, meaning those full fat cells just grow bigger and bigger. And then in an effort to relieve pressure, they start leaking these fatty acids, which have to end up somewhere. And where is that somewhere? In between all the body organs, within the liver, and inside that muscle tissue. Why again? Because there's nowhere else for these floating fats in the blood to go. Thus, it now creates this thunderstorm of metabolic issues. And it is precisely this redirection of fats which is responsible for many of the health problems, including cardiovascular disorders, insulin resistance, type 2 diabetes, and fatty liver. If that calorie energy imbalance continually persists over time and adipose fat cells continue to expand and get bigger and bigger, they end up physically pushing on each other and are forced away from blood vessels. So they become oxygen deficient, thus they suffocate. These fat cells then have to double down and secrete even more pro-inflammatory proteins, which reconfigures blood flow back to the area in a process called angiogenesis. This process also results in the formation of stiff and fibrous tissue or collagen deposits, which trap and then bind these fat cells even further from storing additional lipids. This secondary dysfunction then adds more fats redirected towards the liver, the muscles, intra-abdominally, causing exponentially more insulin resistance. Insulin resistance is essentially an inflammatory response to several variables at work. 1, excessive energy intake. 2, hyperinsulinemia or high insulin levels. 3, stress hormones. And 4, eating the wrong types of fats. We in this modern society have been trained to now eat around the clock, especially highly refined carbohydrate-based packaged foods. At the heart of it all, the continual spiking of our insulin levels day and night. We have been taught, actually brainwashed by our health organizations in conjunction to the food manufacturers, to eat most of our calories, A, from carbohydrates, and then to add insult to injury, we need to eat or snack every 2 hours or so to keep our energy levels up. Our experts insist 6 little meals per day is ideal, but what cannot be denied, elevated insulin levels comes with this advice. Insulin is that master hormone that determines which type of fuels we burn for energy. When chronically elevated, it also signals fat cells to take in more fat, hoard it, and store as much as it can. This is the absolute worst advice one can follow, especially if you have hypertrophic fat cells, as you are now starting to see. When one wakes up in the morning, insulin has just come down during that overnight fast. Then you're instructed to immediately, quote unquote, eat that most important meal of the day, breakfast. A starchy breakfast, which includes oatmeal, cereals, bagels, toast, fruit, milk, all high in carbohydrates, which then spikes up insulin for another 2 to 3 hours. Over time, as fat cell dysfunction occurs, insulin can remain high for as much as 3 to 5 hours. And right when it starts to come back down, they have that mid-morning carbohydrate snack, and they do it for lunch, and they do it for the afternoon snack, and they do it again for dinner, and then the evening snack. And every moment of the day is spent in a state of elevated insulin. So not only is it forcing the fat cells to grow bigger and bigger, but when insulin is chronically high, you simultaneously cannot burn that fat for energy. Please remember, all the excessive carbohydrates we eat are being converted to fats, triglycerides, by the liver. And insulin's job is to store and lock in all that circulating lipids in our fat cells. And as you know now, if you are diabetic, you genetically have fat cells that are inherently unhealthy and are incapable of storage because they're already full. If this continues, you're in deep trouble. That fat now becomes visceral fat stored, again, in between all your organs, in the liver, and deep within that muscle tissue. The most interesting thing about visceral fat, it acts like an organ in your body, but instead of it contributing to your health, it actively works against it. Once these stages begin to occur, blood sugars start to slowly creep up, and then boom, overnight, it shoots up like a rocket and remains high. This is when diabetes is fully diagnosed because that pancreas just cannot keep up with producing more and more insulin. It becomes damaged and simply it burns out. In my humble opinion, if your fasting and waking blood sugars are above 100 milligrams a deciliter, you are already diabetic. Dysfunction has started. Maybe one cannot change stress immediately, and I won't discuss stress or other sources of inflammation today, but you can change insulin levels immediately by modifying diet and food choices. I don't want someone to misunderstand. I don't think all carbohydrates are inherently bad. What we've done is that we've drastically changed how we eat those carbohydrates. The vast majority of people are now getting their carbohydrates from bags and boxes with barcodes. And these are highly refined, basically straight sugar. The other main concern for the explosion of diabetes around the world is due to the tremendous shift in the last century in the types of fats that we eat. Whereas traditional foods like beef and eggs were a primary source of fat. Now, most people get their fats from highly processed seed and vegetable oils, which I have said in numerous episodes are pro-inflammatory, like soybean oil, the most common fat source in the American diet. Producers enrich these vegetable oils and other processed seed oils with omega-6 acids, linoleic acid. The more linoleic acid we eat, the more we store it in our fat cells. When linoleic acid increases, so does its metabolic byproducts. These byproducts force that fat cell to grow through hypertrophy, which we do not want. We want fat cells to stay a more modest size, recruiting more fat cells to help if needed. Now that you know what causes insulin resistance or diabetes in the first place, we can now start to unwind the dysfunction and begin the process of healing ourselves. One must first focus on controlling insulin through diet modifications, and then and only then can consider times of fasting. Second, if you have not done so already, you have to remove all sources of vegetable oils from your diet. Go back to traditional fats like butter, lard, and ghee. Olive oil and avocado oil are also good oils. I'll put a link in the description box below in an episode I just did on avocado oil. The vast majority of these healthy monounsaturated oils on supermarket shelves are unfortunately adulterated, oxidized, and poisonous if you don't know what to look for. So be careful with the brands that you do buy. But in general, the cooking fats I just mentioned are not only very heat stable, but most importantly, are higher in the good omega-3 fats and are low in the pro-inflammatory omega-6 fats. That alone will bring down some of that systemic inflammation. You moderate, remove, control, or even restrict the true cause, the excessive refined carbohydrates and the vegetable oils, and then and only then will the body be capable of staying healthy. Also, maintaining and keeping your muscle is that single critical task we as diabetics have towards normalizing and controlling blood sugars. This leads to living that independent life free of complications, and that is all done by eating the right amounts of the most important macronutrient in our diet, protein. So I bet many of you have more additional questions like, how much protein does a diabetic need per day? What are the best kinds of protein? I will set up a playlist for you with the answers to those great questions. And I'll even expose more deceit and misunderstandings doctors and nutritionists are taught to this very day about this vital macronutrient. The first link you will see will be to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second link will be to that playlist on protein. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released bi-weekly. Bye for now.